Welcome to this lecture on the energy chain. Having a good understanding of what we call the energy chain is essential to understand how to achieve sustainable and energy efficient buildings. So, what is this energy chain? Much like a logistic supply chain for goods, it is the flow of energy between the demand side and the production or supply side. The energy chain gives us a structure to find out on which parts of the system to act from the viewpoint of technology, and it also tells us something about actors to involve. Let's first zoom out to see the complete chain in order to understand what the differences are between demand and supply and the processes leading from one to the other. The energy chain consists of four main components, pictured here from left to right. The first one is the supply side, consisting of all natural resources needed to produce energy, the so-called primary resources. The second one is the energy conversion process, by which natural resources are converted into useful energy in the form of electricity, heat, or cold. The third part of the chain consists of the energy storage and distribution of this energy to and inside buildings. Finally, we have the last part of the chain, which is the energy demand in a building. The relationship between the energy chain and environmental impacts like resource depletion and various emissions like CO2 emissions is indicated above the supply side of the chain. Indeed, these environmental impacts occur on the supply side rather than on the demand side. This slide contains a lot of information, so we are now going to briefly address each of these parts. Let's start with the supply side, the natural resources needed to produce energy. These natural resources are divided into four categories. Two of them are fossil fuels, they are indicated by a brown color. Two of them are renewables, and they have been given a green color. Resource depletion takes place when fossil fuels are used. That's why it has been given a brown color too. When renewables are used, there is, by definition, no resource depletion. Now, let's take a closer look at these natural resources. First, the renewables. Combustible renewables are converted into energy by being burned. Think, for instance, of wood pellets, biomass, or biogas. They have been given a dark green color to indicate that although they can be considered much greener than fossil fuels, their actual greenness is debated. Let's consider now the light green box, non-combustible renewables. These renewables can be converted to energy without being burned. Think of wind or solar energy, hydropower, geothermal energy, or even fuel cells powered by green hydrogen. Let's go now to the fossil fuels, the two brown boxes in the middle, which are responsible for resource depletion. The combustible ones are well known. Think of coal, gas, or oil. As for the non-combustible ones, we are talking about resources like uranium for nuclear energy or hydrogen for fuel cells when it is produced by reforming of natural gas. You may have noticed that we grouped these three of our resources types together and labeled them primary energy. Primary energy is a very important concept. It is based on physics and chemistry and represents the energy content of the natural resources. Because all energy contents are expressed in the same unit, megajoule, or sometimes also kiloton oil equivalents, it allows for using one single indicator to compare the resources used to produce energy. It is therefore very useful for engineers and policymakers when they want to compare the sustainability of diverse alternatives. This is also the reason why most regulations on energy refer to primary energy use and not to the energy demand. Non-combustible renewables, the light green ones on the slide, also consume primary energy. Think of the solar radiation needed by solar panels. This primary energy is very important for engineers trying to design a system with the highest possible efficiency. However, in terms of policy for sustainability, this primary energy can be considered to be zero, because solar radiation or wind are infinite and therefore it doesn't matter how much of them we are using. Of course, there are many discussions about the sustainability of, let's say, biomass. And in general, it is agreed that because it costs much more time to grow it than to burn it, it cannot be considered completely renewable. The primary energy attributed to it by policymakers will then be fixed to a value between zero and the physical energy content of this biomass. The most important part of primary energy is the one connected to the fossil fuels, the brown boxes, because it is a direct measure of the use of natural resources. So, in the end, from a policy point of view, we will consider only the primary energy of fossil fuels and to some extent that of combustible renewables. Let's look now at how to convert these primary resources into usable energy. Usable forms of energy in buildings are electricity, heat and cold, as you can see in the middle of the slide. Be also aware that electricity itself can be used to produce heat or cold, see the blue arrow, but that is not the subject of this lecture. Depending on the type of resource and the conversion method, emissions of harmful products may take place. Think, for instance, of CO2 or NOx emissions or particulate matter. In this slide, the emissions are pictured in orange, just like the two upper conversion boxes. This is to indicate that emissions only take place during the burning process and processes like the nuclear one. In a green box, where conversion takes place based on non-combustible renewables, no such emissions are produced. To make this more concrete, let's have a quick look to some of these conversion processes. First, there is the burning process, using fossil fuels like gas or coal, or renewables like biomass or wood pellets. These resources are burned in a boiler to produce heat or electricity and unfortunately also emissions. As previously mentioned, burning renewables also contributes to emissions like CO2, as the absorption of CO2 by biomass is a process of months or years, while burning it is a process of minutes or hours. When we talk about the energy conversion of non-combustible fossil fuels, we refer to processes like nuclear energy or fuel cells using hydrogen produced from gas. Here too, electricity and heat can be produced. With nuclear energy, there are no CO2 emissions, but there are other emissions like gamma radiation and nuclear waste. The production of the hydrogen used in fuel cells also leads to various emissions. Finally, the last category, the light green boxes, describes things like photovoltaic conversion of solar radiation to electricity, solar thermal, hydropower, wind, geothermal energy, etc. They are used to produce electricity, heat, and even cold. No emissions take place during the energy conversion process. Of course, there are always emissions relating to the making of the conversion systems. Think of the materials used to build a power plant or to manufacture a boiler or a photovoltaic cell or a wind turbine. Considering these emissions is important in terms of sustainability and circularity, but is not the subject of this course. And last but not least, be aware that these energy conversion steps can take place at different spatial levels. First, they can be in the building itself. Think of an individual gas boiler or solar panels on the roof. Second, They can be at the level of a group of apartments, like when a collective boiler is used in an apartment building. Third, they can be at neighborhood or city level. Think of a municipal district heating based on waste burning or geothermal heat. Finally, they can be regional, national, or even supranational. Think of power plants. The location of the conversion matters for the distribution systems and the storage needed. Let's go to the next step in the chain, distribution and storage. How to store and distribute energy depends a lot on the type of energy transported. Is it heat, cold, electricity? Heat produced in a boiler must be distributed to each room through piping and radiators. The cold air in the airco in an office building must be transported to each room too. The heat produced by a municipal waste incineration plant will sometimes need to be stored in large buffers and must be transported to each building through district heating pipes, and then from each building into each room and to tap water. The electricity produced by photovoltaic cells on the roof must be distributed to the building or stored in a battery or supplied to the grid. The electricity produced in a power plant must be distributed too. In the end, all this energy must be enough to answer the demand in the building. Energy demand, the last step in our chain, is the term used to describe the amount of energy needed to make a building comfortable and usable for the desired activities of its occupants. The energy demand is influenced a lot by building design. Reducing energy demand is obviously important as a way of reducing primary energy. Even when using non-combustible renewables, this will help reduce the needed number of photovoltaic cells of wind turbines, which is good for the environment and will also help increase the economic feasibility of these renewables. Additionally, using renewables often induces the use of low-temperature heating, and this in turn influences the building design and the energy demand. So, the energy demand is about the needs for energy. What we need in a building is a nice temperature, good air quality, not too much draft, no rain, hot tap water for showering, cold places to conserve food, enough light, and also power for tools like laptops, television, hobbies, etc. For all these things, a certain amount of energy is required that the building engineer needs to estimate and to optimize. So, we know now how the energy chain looks like. We know that many policies and regulations address directly primary energy. Because we have a chain, this means that energy demand is addressed too in these policies, but in an indirect way, as an underlayer of primary energy. And of course, there are also national or local building codes in many countries that address the energy demand very specifically. Think of regulations on insulation, for instance. There are two things that still need to be clarified. How does this energy chain relate to international and national statistics on energy, and how does it relate to energy bills? If you look carefully at national and international statistics, see the example of the European Union on the slide, you will discover the term final energy consumption. The definition of this term is not completely in line with the definitions we have used in the energy chain. That is because the energy chain is based on a thermodynamic view on energy, while national statistics take an economic and logistic-based approach, looking at what is delivered to buildings rather than at primary energy. Let's take a closer look at this. We are going to zoom in on the building itself. Pay attention to the white building on the right and look at what happens at its boundaries. What is delivered to buildings may be gas, wood pellets, oil, which are primary resources, and also, not to forget, sun if there are PV cells on the roof, wind in case of a roof turbine, or geothermal heat if a geothermal heat pump is used. The energy conversion takes place inside the boundaries of the building. Think of a gas boiler, solar tap water heating, and so on. These are individual systems, and the building occupant or owner is paying directly for the primary resources he, she is using. But very often too, already converted energy is being provided to the building. Think of heat or cold, if there is a district heating or cooling network, or electricity from the grid. And these are not primary resources. They have to be produced by using primary resources. By definition, the final energy use is this. In other words, these are the primary and non-primary energy resources provided to a building. These are also the resources the consumer is paying for. They correspond with the energy bill. It is therefore a very important concept for economic analysis and financial feasibility studies. However, when it comes to environmental impacts like resource depletion and CO2 emissions, looking at primary energy is essential. To summarize, in this lecture, we have seen that the energy chain consists of four parts. First, the supply of natural resources. The energy content of these natural resources is called the primary energy. Second, the conversion of these resources to electricity, heat, and cold. During conversion, emissions like CO2 emissions can take place. In a third step, this electricity, heat, and cold are distributed to and in the building and must be enough to satisfy the energy demand. The energy demand is the fourth step in the chain and is about what is needed by the building and its occupants. Make sure you master the definitions of energy demand, primary energy, and final energy, and be aware of the differences between them.